All right. 20 years ago, almost to the day, on April 4, 1994, I made Aliyah. Not bad. Thank you. Thanks for that. You know, when I speak to an audience in Hebrew, when I'm in front of an Israeli audience, and I get up on stage and I say, Boker tov, korim li Guy Spigelman, va'ani aliti mi Australia. So yeah, the audience kind of does that, but it goes on and on and on, and then they just keep on clapping, and I should probably just stop there, because I never get quite as good a response towards the end of the speech, right? So, and then I think to myself, well, why are they clapping? What, you know, I just, you know, moved from Australia to Israel. And then I think, well, I need to let you on a little secret on the reason I actually made Aliyah when I made Aliyah. And what I'm about to say now, it mightn't be exactly Zionistically correct. That's like the Zionist version of politically correct. I made Aliyah because I just wanted everyone to leave me alone. You see, before making Aliyah, I was the federal mazkir of Habonim Dror in Australia. So, as you may imagine, a week in the life of federal mazkir of Habonim Dror Australia, what that involves is going to meeting after meeting after meeting and getting phone call after phone call after phone call. And it could be the State Zionist Council president or parent or fellow madrichim. And I was just exhausted. I was sick of actively having to be Zionist and Jewish. I just wanted to be, and I had this brainwave. I thought, what's the one way I can be a Zionist hero and have everyone leave me alone? I can make Aliyah. And that's what I did. I became an apathetic Israeli. I paid my taxes and went to Miluim and went to the beaches and the bars, and I complained a lot. But that was it. I could be left alone and live out the dream of just being. Well, it kind of didn't work out that way, but we'll get to that soon. But if I go back to my movement days, some of the things I remember most and the things that still sort of give me the sort of goosebumps is, you know, it's the informal things when you sit around the campfire and you sing David Broza and you listen to Cat Stevens and Bob Dylan. Do you still do all of that?
Yeah.
Bob Dylan, Cat Stevens, you know who they are? Yeah, okay, that's good. I'm just checking, you know, 42, right? So, and when you have those moments, at least when I did, you kind of had this feeling here. This feeling that, wow, anything's possible. I can go out and change the world. I can make a really big change. And actually, when you're in a movement and you're a madrich, you get a chance to start shaping the world when you're actually educating your chanichim that come every week or it's camp, and you get to shape their minds just like your minds were shaped. And that's really powerful. And some of the things we taught and we were taught was that Zionist youth leaders 50 years ago, 100 years ago, well, they were part of the big story, right? They led the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. They built kibbutzim and moshavim and towns from scratch. They formed units in the Palmach and the Haganah. They helped free Soviet Jewry. That's huge. But the question is, that's all been done. So what does that leave for us to do? What's our role? How is there still a huge challenge for us now, today, in the movements to shape what's going on? I would say yes, and I would say some of the challenges we have are even greater than those ones we had in the past. You see, the early Zionist movement, they thought they had a blank canvas. They could just start painting from scratch. And the Jewish world last century faced enormous existential threats. Unbelievable. We have a canvas that looks something like this sort of Jackson Pollock. It's not a real one, it's an imitation one that everyone can create at jacksonpollock.org. And as you can see, it's kind of loud and messy and bright and busy, a little bit like Israel, really. And the Jewish world today, the challenges we face, they're not external anymore. They're mainly internal. And that's a lot more difficult if you think about it. So here's the point. The point today is, how are you going to define where you're going to make your mark on the canvas? How are you going to get a group of people together, choose a point, and make a real impact on the one that's already here? There aren't any new canvases anymore, and that's okay. That really is okay. Because our job is not to make new, but to make better. I want to let you in on a story from 1990. In 1990, I was on Schnapp. That's a long time ago. And I don't know about you guys, but at the end of the Schnapp year, we got together and had a Veda, and a sort of a conference where we would debate ideology and pass resolutions, and we would decide what we're going to do with the movements. And a few of us said, well, you know what, we have another idea. We're going to ask the question, what's the big story going on today in the Jewish people? What is the big story? And without a doubt, in 1990, the big story going on was the freedom of Eastern European Jewry. They had the chance to come and make Aliyah, and they were rebuilding their communities. So a group of us asked, what could we, as 18 and 19-year-old Australians and New Zealanders, any New Zealanders in the room? Yay. So we asked the question, what can we do? What skills do we have so that we can be part of this story? And we heard that Habu Nim Dror was being reformed in Hungary and that they were about to have their first winter camp since 1946. So a group of us, instead of at the end of our Schnapp year going to Paris and Amsterdam, we said, we want to go and help start this new Habu Nim in Hungary and join the new summer camp. And that's what we did. We got on a train in Rome, and it was an overnight train, and through the snow to Vienna and then to Budapest. And we really helped the first Habu Nim Dror camp, and it was a lot of fun. And we had a huge impact. If I'm being really honest, though, probably the thing they remember us most for, do you know that skit on a skit night where you get the toothbrush and you start brushing and you spit it out and the next person does it and they get the toothbrush and spit it out and yet they're there. And then the last person drinks it, right? So apparently for years after our trip to Hungary, that's what they remember. But seriously speaking, and this is me over here, if this clicker works, it's not working. Anyway, this is me. Just this guy here with a lot of hair. I use this to prove to my kids that I actually had hair once. Yeah, I know. But seriously, it was a pioneering trip because after that, it became common practice for Zionist youth leaders from all over the world to help reform the Zionist youth movements in Eastern Europe. So now I want to tie this in to what I'm doing today. If you may recall, I made Aliyah, why? So that everyone would leave me alone and I could be an apathetic Israeli and just go about my life paying taxes, miluim, raising kids, that sort of thing. And then in 2002, there was an election campaign here. And then on the radio, there was this song by the Dan Reichel Project called Boy. And it kind of struck me here, you know, that point here, and things started to stir. And then I had this light bulb moment. There's meant to be a light bulb here, and it'll come up soon. I had this light bulb moment, and I'm going to say something now that I've never actually verbalized in public. It might actually get me thrown off the stage, but I'm going to say it, and so I just need a second to gather my thoughts and actually get it out. All right. I realized back then in 2002 that Israel... Okay, I'm going to say this. Hold on. I realized that Israel was not perfect. Okay, hold on. You're still here, right? I'm still on the stage. They're not throwing me off. And not only did I realize... I'll flash forward. It's okay. I'll get to the light bulb. There we go. Not only did I realize that it was not perfect, it was freaking far from being perfect. And I'm raising my kids here, and someone has to do something about it. And I'm one of those someones. So then in 2002, I started to get involved again. I started to put dots on the canvas and lines, and people started to call me and bother me, and I used to go to meetings and meetings and meetings, and it was fine. And I really wanted to. And now I want to let you know what I'm doing today and how it ties into what I'm doing today. Because I've kind of come full circle. I have the privilege today to work for an amazing organization called Present Tense Israel. And what we do is we help Israelis in communities across the country and Jewish people around the world fulfill their dreams. We provide them with training in entrepreneurial skills and innovative skills so that they can go and launch their ventures. It's not just about teaching them how to fish. It's about teaching them how to build their own fishing rod factories. And the reason we do this is because, has anyone heard of the startup nation? Israel is a startup nation. Show of hands. Israel's the idea that we're a powerhouse of innovation. Well, unfortunately, only 15% of Israel lives in the startup nation. The other 85% are left behind. So we at Present Tense are bringing the power of innovation to 100% of Israel. And we're doing this to help grow the economy, enrich community life, and to solve some core problems of Israeli society. One of the programs we do is in Ra'anana. It's about helping develop new ventures to help people with disabilities. One guy has developed an iPhone application that you can control with your eye movements. So if you're a quadriplegic, suddenly the iPhone is totally accessible. Or another woman from Jerusalem, she set up a program that has trained 700 youth at risk to recycle old computers and give them to educational institutions, achieving a triple bottom line. It's good for the economy, it's good for the society, and it's good for the environment. And this is the kind of stuff I do every day, and it's a real privilege. One of the big issues that we're tackling is how we treat the minorities among us in Israel, the Arab Israelis. I mean, in the Torah, 13 times the mitzvah of Ahavat Ager is mentioned. It's the most commonly mentioned mitzvah. And in Israel, we have a big gap between the status of the Arab Israelis and of Jewish Israelis. And all around the world, we're fighting for the rights of the Jewish minority. So what are we going to do about it here? I mean, to give you a statistic, 19% of the graduates of the Technion, they're Arab Israelis. Yet Arab Israelis make up only 2% of the engineering workforce. So what we're doing is we set up a program in Nazareth called NASTEC. And NASTEC is the first accelerator program for Arab Israeli startups. And we're giving them the skills and tools. And these are skills and tools that I developed over 15 years in a career in high tech. I'm now able to give to these guys so they can be part of the next startup nation story. And here I am again, you see, only this time I look a little bit more serious. Just a little bit more. But for me, it's actually the same story. And it can be your story too. You too can be part of this great building of a ground-up nation. You see, what I'd like you to do is this. I'd like you, with a bunch of friends, to go and find out what story you're going to be part of, which part of the canvas you're going to make your mark on. And then with your fellow travelers, I want you to apply your skills, the passion and talents that you already have, and to go out and make a really big change in the world. And if I can help, I'd love to. So please, don't leave me alone. Thanks.